Pleasant morning to everyone. God has been good to us, amen.
Amen.
And what a privilege, and I say it is a privilege for us to be here this morning, amen. Because I've discovered that a lot of folks went to sleep last night and they didn't get up this morning. And in the medical field, they tell us that the majority of deaths happen during the night. And the doctor said, well, if he can make it through the night, he or she stands a good chance.
Amen.
If he can only make it through the night. Amen?
Amen.
And if God do it for you, we can make it. Amen?
Amen.
The psalmist tells us to make a joyful noise unto the Lord.
All ye lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with
singing,
knowing that the Lord,
he is God.
It is he that has made us and not yourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him.
Bless his name.
And bless his name, for the Lord
is good.
His mercy is everlasting and his truth endureth to all generations. Amen. Oh, God is an old-fashioned God, because he's the same yesterday,
today,
and forevermore. He never changes. And what a privilege it is for me to be able to speak to us this morning. Because you never know. I always count it a privilege whenever I'm asked to speak a word from the Lord. Not only that, it is a high calling. Amen. It is not my words, it is his words. I invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Loving Father in heaven, we come before your throne of grace to give you thanks for being so good to us. As we are about to open your words, open our minds and give us understanding. May we learn something that will draw us closer to you. Help us to be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. Speak to me, through me, and for me. And let your words be riveted into every fiber of our lives. May it elicit from us a response. Let us be drawn closer to you. May we learn something that will fit us for eternity. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I received some good news this week, as Ray mentioned. I received a call from my niece one early morning, a test I did 2 weeks ago, and she said to me, I have some good news. And then my brother called me later on during the day, and he was so excited. In my wildest imagination, I could never imagine that he would quote a scripture. Now you gotta keep in mind that we came from Hinduism. And he said to me, when I embraced the knowledge of Christ, he said to me, I was born a Hindu, and I'm gonna die a Hindu. You know, one day when Moses was on a mountain, and the children of Israel were dancing before the calf, God said to Moses, go down there, the people that you have brought out of Egypt. And then Moses caught himself and he said, oh no, the people that you have brought, amen, not me, the people that you have brought out of Egypt. And then he sent me a message that I sent to him some time ago. And he said, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High
shall abide
under the shadow of the Almighty. God is an amazing God. And I don't know who was more excited. Was it him or was it I? Amen. So the test came back positive, and he said, Brother B, he said, we are an exact match.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
So, Jesus, and I sent him home so he can strengthen his body. So keep us in your prayers that all will go well. Amen.
Amen.
So when he's all fit to go, I'll be able to do the transfusion for him so he can live by God's grace in normal life.
Amen.
But it's not only to save a person that he can live in this world. Because if they can live to a ripe old age, free of sickness and disease, and they end up lost, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? We can be in the best of health physically, but we can be spiritually dead. So only God can work a miracle in his life. Amen?
Amen.
And then the problem, too big or too small, that God cannot handle. Amen?
Amen.
Once he gets your blood can be under your preaching too.
But if he gets the blood of Jesus, that's the right time.
Amen.
For every individual, for every age, every time period, and the blood of Jesus has already built into it the power to live above sin.
Amen.
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 Has all the antibodies in it.
There you go.
That fights the infection that invades the human body. Amen.
Yes.
There is still a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath the flood lose all their guilty stains. The efficacious blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. There is power
in the blood.
In the blood. Amen. For those of you who love titles, I've entitled the message, Donkeys and Horses. I want you to put your thinking cap on, and I'm going to say some things probably some of you have not heard before. So I'll attempt to tell us something that we maybe do not already know in a different light. Amen? And I've used as our scripture reading the book of Exodus. Ex or dust, that means the way out. Exodus chapter 13 and verse 13, and it reads, "And every firstling of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb. And if thou wilt not redeem it, then thou shalt break his neck, and all the firstborn of man among thy children shalt thou redeem." God has always reserved the firstborn among humans to be special to him, to be dedicated and committed to him for the purpose of teaching, for the purpose of ministering, for the purpose of transmitting the gospel, not only within the context of Israel, but also to the Gentile nation to represent the God of heaven.
Amen.
But it was also necessary for the Israelites to redeem amongst the unclean animals some of them. Paramount was the donkey. The donkey was an unclean animal, but it was necessary to redeem the donkey for certain cares, for certain reasons, to bear the burdens of the Israelites. And the chiefest was the donkey. But the donkey, the firstborn of the donkey, could not be used just like that. It had to go through a ceremony. A ceremonial process was necessary in order for the donkey, the firstborn, to be used. It had to be redeemed by the blood of the lamb. And if you fail to redeem the firstborn, then God will say to Israel, it's better you break the neck of the thing and cast it out as dead. So it's better if you redeem the firstborn of the donkey. Now the donkey did not become clean. It was simply pronounced clean. And I want you to bear that in mind, amen? It was redeemed. It was pronounced clean. But it was still unclean, amen? It was accepted and it was used by the Israelites. Now I got you thinking because there's silence in the church. Amen? God loves us, what do you say? And you'll see where all of us fit in this scenario. Amen?
Amen.
God loves us. I turn your attention to the book of Exodus, chapter 15, and verse 1. See, when the children of Israel was free to go out of Egypt, verse 1 says, "Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider had he thrown into the sea." Now the horse back in those days belonged to the elite, belonged to the powerful nation. Those who were self-sufficient. You will not read about the horse amongst Israelites. The horse was not permitted amongst God's people. It was used only for the powerful nations. It was like the German tanks, or the Cessna, or the bomber, or the hydrogen bomb. It was an instrument of war. It was an instrument of pride, of self-sufficiency for the powerful nations, the elite, those who are mighty. But God did not allow the horse to be amongst the Israelites. He allowed the donkey, a jackass, if you please. And by the way, that's a biblical word. Amen? That's another name for the jump, for the donkey, an ass. And so after they left Egypt, and by the way, the best trained horses in the world are the Arabian horses. And the trainer would train the horse so much, and there was one final test that he would give these horses. The horse would be starved for 3 days without water. And then the trainer would bring the horses that have been trained to the watering hole. And imagine the curse and the horses seeing the lake with water. And before they could delve into the lake, the trainer would blow the whistle one more time. And the horse that turns back, only the ones that turn back, imagine they are dying from thirst, only the ones that turn back and listen to the whistle, listen to the voice of the trainer, only those graduated to the next level. The ones that delve into the lake and ignore the voice of the whistle, they go back to the training camp. Those are the best trained horses, even today. And those are the horses that the Egyptians have, the Arabian horses. And could you imagine the pride riding on those talent, on those horses? Have you ever ridden on a horse? That's a majestic beast. I remember when I rode on one of those horses there in Camp Kalaka. And we didn't get a gallop on those horses because it was my first time. And they just allowed me to sit on the horse, and you can go down the trail. There was a number of us, you know, and it's as though they had set those horses where they had to just walk. But just sitting on those majestic beasts, can you imagine? I felt a certain amount of pride. Mm. I was on a war horse, amen? I couldn't imagine how the Egyptians felt. Historians tell us that when the Israelites left Egypt, they rode on horses, but when the Israelites left Egypt, they left on donkeys and by foot. There were no horses amongst them. And the Israelites were looked down upon. There was scorn by the Egyptians. And they had coined the phrase that Israel worshipped the donkey. and they mocked Israel. And even when a musical band was being organized, they failed to sound the trumpet because they said that the trumpet sounded like a bray of an ass. So they had implanted scorn and rejection on the children of Israel. But friend of mine, God uses that which seems impossible. And even Zechariah 9 and verse 9 says, your king cometh lowly, not riding on a stallion, but riding upon a donkey, the foal of an ass. And by the way, Jesus rode on a donkey, yet being unborn, in Mary's womb. When Joseph was told to go and pay taxes by Caesar to his jurisdiction, Mary had to ride on a donkey, fully pregnant. And Jesus, yet being unborn, comes to us riding on a donkey. And by the way, the foal of a donkey is the foal of an ass is a grown donkey that had not been yoked before. Amen. That had not yet borne the burdens of life. And I'll say a little more on this, and this is a text for young people, amen, who have not yet borne the burdens of life. I want to give us some more passages. God loves us, what do you say?
Amen.
He loves us with an everlasting love, amen. Our God is a mighty God, what do you say, amen?
Amen.
He uses that which seems even impossible. Genesis chapter 22 and verse 3. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 22 and verse 3. Even Abraham. And God called Abraham out of pagan idolatry. Abraham was an idol worshiper. His father's name was Terah, out of Mesopotamia. And God said to him, and by the way, Abraham was a multi-millionaire. But they didn't read that he rode on any horse. Amen. And all that Abraham became was a direct blessing from God. Amen.
Amen.
Even when he was told to go and offer his son, his only son that he loved, as a sacrifice. Verse 3 says, and Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass, and took two of his young men with him, and Isaac his son, and clave the wood for the burnt offering, and rose up and went unto the place of which God had told him. Abraham saddled his ass, and went to the place where God had told him that I will meet you there to sacrifice your son. Amen. Abraham was 50 rich. He has donkeys, he had camels, he has goats, he had a great flock. He had servants born in his own house, that he had his own army. Amen? But you do not read that he had horses. The horses were not permitted in Israel. And God had planned it like that. God had willed it to be like that. Because God wanted to teach us a lesson. Amen? And you stay with me for the next few minutes. You'll get the message, amen? God willed it like that. The horse came into Israel slowly and illegally. It was not permitted by God. He permitted the donkey, an unclean animal. If redeemed, could be used. But it had to go through the redeeming process, amen? The hymn writer said, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child, and forever I am. Redeemed means to buy back. Redeemed means to purchase. Redeemed means to get back that which was gotten by fraud and deception. Amen?
Amen.
Thank God for the redeeming blood of Jesus. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 42 and verse 26. You know, when Joseph was in Egypt, and God blessed him through various circumstances and situations, he was in a position of great authority and prominence. Amen. And when he interpreted the dream about the fat corn and the seven fat cows and the seven skinny cows, and he told Pharaoh in advance what was going to happen, and his advice to Pharaoh was, choose somebody. And Pharaoh said, there is not a better man than you. Amen. And so he was chosen, and there was grain laid up in Egypt, not only to sustain the Egyptians, but the surrounding nations. And the grain ran out amongst Jacob and his entourage. And verse 26 says, Jacob said to his sons, go to Egypt and get some grain. And they landed up the asses with the corn and departed hence. Even the sons of Jacob came to get corn from Egypt. Not on horses, amen, but on donkeys. Judges chapter 15 and verse 16. What book did I say? Judges chapter 15 and verse 16. Now God loves us, amen. And there's a lesson here for every one of us. You know, when God wanted to send a message, when he wanted to teach a nation who was a hindrance to Israel, he wanted to teach them a lesson through his servant. And verse 16 says, and Samson said, with the jawbone of an ass, heaps upon heaps, with the jaw of an ass have I slain a thousand men. Now, the ass, the donkey, was looked down upon. And yet God used Samson. His strength was not in his hair. The power was not in the jawbone of an ass. The power comes from God, amen?
Amen.
But yet even the animal that the nations looked down and ridiculed Israel about and saying that they worship the head of the donkey, Samson said with the jawbone of an ass, I have sent 1,000 men to the dust. Mm-hmm. And in our land, we said they kicked the bucket. Yeah. Amen. He had brought them down to dust with the jawbone of an ass. So unlikely. On the cross was a Roman death machine. It was their pride. It was invented by the Phoenicians. Later on, embraced by the Egyptians. And when Rome came along, Rome modified the cross. And they used it for capital punishment. It was a symbol of shame. If you were identified with the cross back in those days, it meant only one thing, and that was death. Shame and humiliation. Not even your relatives were told to feel sorry for you. When Jesus ended up on the cross, that was the greatest throne that he would ever sit upon. Amen. He triumphed by his death. He destroyed him that had a power over death. That is the devil. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus hanging on the cross on the shameful condition that he was in. He destroyed him that had the power over death, and he came out victorious.
Amen.
He was the mighty conqueror.
Yes.
Even as a Roman death machine,
yes.
Jesus lives. And because he lived, you and I can face tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
Because we serve a mighty God. We don't serve a dead God. We don't serve a puny God. And my God had no problem exposing himself.
He lives.
There was some commentators say that there was a shortage of horses. I choose to differ. You see, where God is concerned, there is no lack. Amen. God has no problem exposing himself. Amen. There's one time when the Syrian army surrounded Dothan because Elisha was telling the king of Israel everything that the Syrian king had planned for him. Let's start the passage, amen. This thing is so good.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I don't want you to take my word for it. 2 Kings chapter 6. What book did I say?
2 Kings 6.
2 Kings chapter 6. Yes. We pick it up. No. The Syrian king said to his cabinet members, because it was not only one time, but every time he laid plans for Israel, his secret was being told. So he concluded there is treason in his cabinet. So he decided to look for the man. There's a spy in here. And one of his servants said, "No, master, there is somebody called Elisha in Dothan." And the Syrian king said, "Go fetch him for me, amen." And the Bible says, from verse 13, and he said, "Go and pray where he is, that I may send and fetch him." And it was told him, saying, "Behold, he is a daughter." Therefore sent he to the horses and chariots and a great host, and they came by night and compassed the city about. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, now this is not Elisha's servant Gehazi, who was stricken with leprosy. This was one of the servants of the prophets, who was wondering why they were cutting the trees. Elisha retrieved the axe that fell on the belly of the river, amen?
Amen.
I love that story, amen?
Yes.
No, the axe was in the belly of the river. And he kept crying to Elisha. I said, "What can I do? The thing is not even mine, it was borrowed." Even if it is borrowed, Elisha had a little talk with Jesus, amen?
Amen.
And he took his mantle and he just put it on the spot. And the Bible says that the axe head, the iron that was in the belly of the river, look at me now, it began to levitate. And it came up on top of the water and it began to slip. Now, if God can cause iron to slip, amen, there is nothing God cannot do, amen.
Amen.
So the secret that was in the king's chamber was told to the king of Israel by Elisha. So he decided, we're going to get him tonight, amen. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth, behold, a host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots, and his servants, and said unto him, "Alas, my master, how shall we fear?" Elisha's servant was afraid. He was scared, and he said, "Master, what are we going to do? What are we going to do?" And he answered, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." Now, never forget that, amen.
Right.
You and I have a guardian angel. Amen. And if indeed God has to empty all heaven, and by the way, let me remind you in case you forget. One angel destroyed of the Assyrians one night and one little blow, 185,000 of the Assyrians.
Amen.
Now, if one angel can do that, and if God has to unleash all the angels of heaven at your disposal, God is willing to do it. Amen?
Amen.
So never underestimate, never feel discouraged, my sister. Never forget how God has led us in the past.
Amen.
Oh, God is here, amen?
Amen.
We serve a mighty God. Amen?
Amen.
Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And Elisha prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." God needs to open our spiritual eyes. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountains was full of horses and chariots of fire. Now, this was not ordinary chariots, amen?
Oh, yeah.
These are not ordinary horses, amen. These are not ordinary soldiers, amen. These are men of war, amen. Round about Elisha. Now God has a hedge of protection not only around Job, but around every one of his children. Amen. And if God be for you, there is nothing that the devil can do